Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The 13th Girl, written by N.V. Peacock and read by Marie Lawrence. Dedication. For those who do not feel normal in this world, you are not alone and are in good company. Prologue. Beautiful, he whispers. Her hair, soft and shiny, slips through his fingers like strands of silk. May I? He asks. Entwining their fingers, he lifts her hand to his lips and places the gentlest of kisses over her skin. I've waited so long. I can't believe we're finally here, together, like this. As the words fall from his mouth, he realizes there is no going back. Everything he has thought about, everything he has ever wanted, is here right now for the taking. All he needs is the courage to reach out and grab it with both hands. Her, this, now. Cradling her head against his chest, he lifts her further into his arms. Romance isn't dead, he thinks, as he subtly maneuvers her onto the park bench where they first met. He knows she won't appreciate this gesture. In truth, her attention is usually taken with something else. Most of their time together she has spent scrolling on her phone or taking selfies for social media. But that doesn't matter now. Today, her attention is fully on him, and for that, he will gift her the ultimate selfie. One that will be shared and liked for years to come, cementing them as a couple for the ages. Until this day, he never thought of himself as romantic. Their relationship, although short, has transformed him from a bumbling wannabe to a dashing gentleman. The kind usually found bound in thick romance novels and 90-minute cliched rom-coms. The breeze catches in her hair, making him smile. Suddenly, the thought of leaving her side even for a minute starts to trail tiny cracks across his heart. He has to get this right. For both of them. I'll make you a star, he tells her. A promise he knows he'll keep. They are already well on the road to becoming something spectacular, the envy of the internet. So relaxed with him, her body settles against his shoulder. Instinctively, his arm encircles her, drawing them closer. Leaning down, he kisses the top of her head, then lingers to take in her scent. Citrus, with a hit of something spicy. It is early morning, but people will be invading their private moments soon. Softly tilting her face to stare into the depths of her eyes, he watches her mouth open, just a little, with expectation. It's now or never, he says. Positioning her just right, he drops to one knee and looks up. From out of his pocket, he pulls out something shiny. Mouth dry, he asks. Would you do me the honour? Voices in the distance. Rising, he looks around. They are still alone. There's time to make this moment truly amazing. Special. My darling, would you do me the honour of being my first official victim? With force, he plunges the knife in his hand through her stomach, angling it down so as to pin the corpse against the wood, allowing it to sit up unaided. Stepping back, he says, Oh, now don't you look pretty. There's less blood than he expected, although he had already spilled quite a bit of it in the last 3 days. With a few minor adjustments to her pose, she appears suspended on the bench, waiting. Mistakenly alive if it weren't for the pallor of her skin and the two hollowed eye sockets. Farewell, my love, he tells her, then strolls off into the park ready to embark on his next relationship. When screams ring out behind him, he doesn't look back. Chapter 1. She's so creepy. Like an extra from a horror film, Stephanie adds. Corinne nudges her friend. You know, she's fresh out of the nut house. Stephanie gasps. Like you said, creepy. I can't deny it. Like dogs and dolphins can smell cancer, People can smell creepiness on me. Every time I meet a new person, their eyes widen and nose wrinkles. I have the distinct whiff of weirdness. This doesn't make my life easy. Humans are social animals. We're programmed to instinctively seek out the acceptance of others. It's in psychologist Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. Dr. Taylor gave me it as a checklist in one of our pre-release sessions. Tick off the ones you think you have, she told me. I stared at it just long enough to realise I couldn't tick many boxes without lying, so put down the pen. To help with this, maintaining a job became part of my release back into the normal world, so I could be part of a team. Thanks to this condition, I now sit at the end of a long office, by a bird poop stained window, enduring overtly loud insults from co-workers while trying my hardest to belong. The people I work with may not talk to me, but I listen to them. I know their secrets. The one who steals, the ones having affairs, the bully, the eternal victim, the amateur Machiavellian, and the backstabber. It's like cliched reality TV. Fascinating, but flawed relationships played out daily to obvious conclusions. And Corinne and Stephanie are always centre stage for every drama. Cake? I look up to see Stephanie being offered the last slice of Corinne's birthday cake. It's common that I'm not offered a slice of, well, anything. I'm conveniently invisible when it comes to office treats. Not that I would accept her cake. It's homemade, and I once saw Corinne go to the toilet and not wash her hands. Right now, I view this not so much as a social slight, but a lucky escape from salmonella. Corinne hands over the red velvet slice to Stephanie, then walks back to her desk. I don't even warrant a polite excuse. No matter, I'll go to the bakery at lunchtime and buy a hygiene-adherent cake, one that's uniform deliciousness is a legal requirement. It takes less than 40 minutes to finish my work. Looking at the clock, I still have an hour left to kill before lunch. To spend that time, I write a to-do list, littered with small tasks like making tea, Googling TV programmes, staring out the window, and of course, listening to my co-workers' gossip. Engrossed in an article about a new true crime documentary, it takes me longer than it should to hear the girls behind me giggling. Our boss, Mr. Lake, a rail-thin, 60-year-old man with dyed black hair, is working the room. This happens at least once a week. Today, I accidentally make eye contact, so he stops at my desk. Quickly, I minimise my screen. How are the invoices coming? His lips silently contort in every letter of the alphabet, trying to remember my name. I've been here a month now, so let him grasp a little longer before saying, Dinah.
Oh, yes, I knew it began with a D, he laughs. Unusual name.
It's from Genesis.
Ah, Phil Collins' band, am I right?
Before I can correct him with the Bible, Mr. Lake publicly murders Easy Lover to a jerky display of dad dancing, a song that isn't even by Genesis. After the performance, he stares at me, as if awaiting applause. Lies aren't my thing, so I say, everyone just calls me Dee. Mr. Lake snorts and swaggers off to flirt with Corinne. By the time I realise I should have told him I need more work, they're both laughing and sliding sly glances my way. Ignoring them, I bend down and release three A4 notebooks from my backpack. They're bulky and hard to manoeuvre, but I eventually yank them free. One book is for my sketches. Dr. Taylor encouraged me to draw people. She thought that in studying those around me, I could learn to be more like them. Not sure it's working, but I do find it relaxing. The second book is for collecting ideas for filming my own documentary. When inspiration comes, it rattles about in my head until I exercise it onto the page. My idea then sits in between the covers, rotting, until I replace it with another. Then the whole process starts over again. A few years ago, my friend, Father Jacob, bought me an online documentary making course. Loving every minute of it, I learnt the steps needed to produce a world-class piece of television. Making a documentary that wins the coveted DocuWow Award is my dream. I'm not sure why it's so hard to get going on this goal. Perhaps I'm so focused on perfection that nothing I come up with is ever good enough. I make a note to talk this over with Dr. Taylor in our next check-in session. You can't finish something you never start. The last book is my journal. This is where I make notes of the things I see and things I don't see, the cakes that pass me by. I scribble a few words on the lack of religious understanding in today's society and then swap to my documentary's notebook. I write, "Is ignorance the new religion?" I'll never do anything with it. I should tear it out and throw it in the bin where it belongs. I don't. Ripping out pages would make my notebook ugly, and I have enough ugliness in my life. Lunchtime. It's a 20-minute walk to the bakery in boiling August heat. It feels as if it's been sunny forever. For the last few weeks, I've all but lived in sunglasses, ironically making the world around me appear darker. Slightly out of breath and with onset sunburn, I arrive at the tiny shop and join the back of the queue. Somewhere in the middle is Stephanie. Clearly the red velvet cake was not enough for her sweet tooth.
"Carrot cake, please, doll," she says to the man behind the counter.
Stephanie calls people things such as doll and my lovely. It sounds sincere when she says it, as if you've earned a badge of honour. I wish I could give out such rewards. Maybe people would like me more if I made them feel something other than weird. But I doubt I can convincingly add doll to the end of my sentences without it coming out as disturbing. With my fiery ginger curls, dark brown eyes and porcelain skin, dressed head to toe in black, Mum has hinted, not so subtly, that I look like one of those Victorian rag dolls. Although in my 30s, I barely look 20. Being locked away does wonders for a wrinkle-free complexion. Once served, Stephanie walks right by me and has the cheek to make eye contact. She then pushes past, as if we were strangers. I understand her reaction. It's not a good idea to be seen talking with the office weirdo. Finally, when I reach the front of the queue, I find only a dodgy-looking egg salad sandwich left. No cakes. Stephanie, once again, got the last slice. A familiar frustration builds in me, so I close my eyes and count backwards from 6, a technique used to activate a different part of my brain, a sort of short circuit, as counting backwards makes me think with my analytical hemisphere. The man behind the counter huffs at my technique, but I don't rush. Instead, I smile sweetly and politely ask for the sandwich, which I then carefully place in the bin outside before starting the long walk back to work. By the freshly poop-stained window, I spend the next torturous hours descending into boredom so deep it's painful. 1 hour before freedom, I Google her. I do this at least once a day, and I'm proud I've lasted this long before typing in her name. Louisa Black. It's a common name, so I usually have to add in the title of the documentary too, but since it's had so much recent exposure on streaming sites, today her name alone is enough. This realization cuts me deep as I search for bad reviews. There's a few out there, like rotten apples in an overgrown orchard. I find a new one on a particularly scathing blog. "Crappy Storytelling and Sketchy Subject Matter" is its title. I can agree with half of that. Louisa is a lackluster storyteller. However, as the subject matter was me, I take umbrage with the sketchy comment. As with all these articles, there's an embedded YouTube video, a 2-minute snatch of the 66-minute programme. I don't click on it. Don't need to. I know exactly the part they've highlighted. Even after all these years, I still feel the red-tinted burn around my wrists from where I was held down. Heat from the stage light scorching my skin. The echoes of screams still sit in my ears. My screams. By heart, I know the words they chanted over and over again. Images of crucifixes dance across my mind's eye, and the touch of a rosary being pulled over my palms itches at my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.